I'm Debbie Levine. I'm the Senior Deputy Editor of Radiology. And I'm here today with a very unique father and son team, Dr. Richard Baum, who's the Herb Abrams Chief of Interventional Radiology at Brigham and Women's Hospital, and Dr. Stanley Baum, who's the Editor of Academic Radiology and a Professor of Radiology at the University of Pennsylvania. And they wrote a really nice review article for us entitled Interventional Radiology, A Half Century of Innovation, that's going to be in our special issue of Radiology that's entitled Exploring the Evolution of Imaging. So Dr. Baum and Dr. Baum, welcome.
Thank you.
You know, it was such a pleasure working with the pair of you on your article, and I know that it was a lot of work to review the literature, not only in radiology, but in other publications as well, and to tie in the whole history of interventional radiology into your review. And I was just wondering, were there any unexpected findings for you as you did this? Maybe we can start with Stanley.
It was interesting, maybe, I simply say, kind of a nostalgic trip back to the beginning of all of this. And what I found so interesting was that in many ways, interventional radiology kind of started many of the therapies that we currently take for granted. As an example, I remember when selective coronary arteriograms were first being done, and the critics said, well, why are you bothering doing these studies, putting patients at risk when nothing could be done for the coronary arteries anyway? And it was only really after different studies began to show major lesions of the coronary artery to disstimulate them, the surgeons to think, well, maybe we can go in and fix these things. And I think this has been the trend throughout, so that first we diagnose something and you look at it and you say, well, it's there, perhaps we can fix it. This is exactly what happened when the daughter started to do angioplasty. It happened when we began doing bleeding studies, where we first diagnosed it and you didn't try to fix it. So it was interesting to see the development of the whole field, and this is especially true when you go through the early literature.
And Richard, do you have anything to add to that?
Yeah, I think it was absolutely remarkable the impact that interventional radiology has had on medicine. It's every specialty, every field. We touch everything, either with procedures we've developed or procedures we currently do. So that for me was the biggest surprise, the sheer scope of what's been developed over the past few years.
And I imagine the two of you, you've kind of got the history. I mean, Stanley, you were there when everything began, and then Richard, as the field has just bloomed and become almost its own specialty, you have that whole history too. How did you find that was to tie into your article?
Well, look at the way Richard practices interventional radiology. There is very little resemblance to what I did when I started. Just to give you an example, when I began doing these studies in the early 60s, radiologists weren't even allowed to write notes on patients' charts. When I was at Mass General, I had to communicate with either in the house office or the referring physician and tell them what I wanted, and they would then put that in the chart. And now I see the way Richard runs his practice, where he has a practice. He has patients, they get admitted to his service, he takes care of them. It's a completely different specialty now.
Yeah, you know, just add to that, it's these specialties evolved on two separate parallel paths. One was, of course, technological advances and different types of procedures we do, but also the approach to taking care of patients, the disease, and clinical medicine. And that has evolved just as much, if not more. That mindset has changed than the procedures that we do.
We really wanted to highlight inflection points of technology and show how hardware and software allowed for changes in diagnosis and management. Can you give an example of this from your own reviews?
Well, again, going back to the early 60s, there were very few departments that actually had image intensification. People were still doing some of these studies on the fluoroscopy. And then when image intensification was introduced, there was no imaging chain, no television chain. So all of this was done through, you know, one individual could look in the mirror and see where a catheter was. it's hard to believe that now, where not only do you have imaging chains, obviously, for the TV, but it's recorded digitally, and you see exactly what you're doing all the time. The other interesting thing is in what has happened to the development of catheters. We've never had preformed catheters. Catheters came in rolls, which we got from Sweden, and they were different sizes, different color-coded. We would make the shape of the catheter according to the patient. The night before, we would kind of measure where we thought the renal artery was from the femoral artery, then put a curve on that. You would heat it up. You had cold sterilization, put the catheters in and some Zephyrin, and the next morning take it out. That was the catheter. The catheter we used, and God forbid if the catheter ever fell on the floor, that was the end of the procedure. So major advances obviously been made.
And Richard, anything from your view?
Me, DSA, and when I first started, everything was butt bump. We have to wait, we would do a series abroad. We benefited from all the advances of the early pioneers. We had image intensifiers, but we had to wait for the film was to be taken to the dark room. It wasn't real time, it was a delay. And now, it's just remarkable, the resolution, the digital imaging, and actually now, not only we have digital imaging, now we can use, hybrid imaging, whether we're from laparoscopy and get some cross-sectional rotational angiograms, or even some modern rooms now that have hybrid imaging. So yeah, it's been remarkable.
And now moving from the past to the present and even the future, what do you see as new developments in imaging that will advance the field of interventional radiology?
I think more hybrid imaging. I think the combination of fluoroscopy to guide catheters with different techniques, whether it's MR, CT, I think we're going to have more and more hybrid rooms. Look, we as interventional radiologists, we're very creative in the way we treat disease, and we use tools to be able to treat problems that were unsolvable in the past. And we, with different types of imaging, can do even more things. And who knows, if you put a CT and an MR and a fluoro, who knows what we'll be able to do a decade from now.
Wonderful. Stanley, what's your prediction for the future?
It's very hard to predict the future. I certainly would not have predicted where we are today 50 years ago. But I think what Richard says is correct. I think we're going to be seeing 3D imaging, and you can see 3D imaging as you do your procedures. It'll be hybrid imaging. We're going to be seeing dual energy kind of CTs where you subtract ribs and vertebra as you do chemoembolization, so you can see the vessels in the liver much better. It's going to be a further advance, and it's difficult to predict.
Well, it's been just really such an honor to work with the two of you, and I just love the idea of having that real history with a family and with the entire history of interventional radiology covered for our journal. So thank you so much, the two of you, for all of your efforts.
Thank you. It was really fun working with my father on this. I had a great time, and thanks for the invitation.
And it was great working. You can imagine the pleasure I had working with my son.
Great.